हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू एट अनदर सेशन ऑन एसए पर्सपेक्टिव्स। सो टॉपिक फॉर टुडे इज डेवलपमेंट मस्ट लीड टू डिसमेंटल ऑल काइंड्स ऑफ ह्यूमन अनफ्रीडम्स। ओके फ्रेंड्स, विदाउट वेस्टिंग मच टाइम लेट अस क्विकली जंप इनटू द टॉपिक। फ्रेंड्स, एज ऑलवेज बिफोर आई बिगिन आई हैव अ पर्सनल रिक्वेस्ट। माई बुक एथिक्स इंटीग्रिटी एंड एप्टीट्यूड हैज बीन पायरेटेड। अनफॉर्चुनेटली pirated book is a low print quality. I request you, I urge all of you to buy original. Original copies can be bought on affordable, from the affordable seller on Amazon, from the Arvind Books seller on Flipkart. Friends, as always, before we begin the essay, we have to conceptualize the essay as being made up of various components. So this essay, can be categorized into these components: introduction, various unfreedoms, then whether all unfreedoms or dismantled by development, what kind of development is needed, and finally the conclusion. Friends, I feel the best way to start this essay is by introducing the lives of two great souls that India has ever produced. One is Dr. B.R. Ambedkar and the second one is Sir M. Visveshwaraya. You can devote the first paragraph to Ambedkar and the second paragraph to Visveshwaraya. In the first paragraph you can very well write stating that Ambedkar came from a very financially poor background, but from a socially depressed classes, yet with his hard work, perseverance and education, he came out of that poverty and penury and he rose to become the father of Indian constitution. Next, under Visveshwaraya, you can very well write that Visveshwaraya also came from a very poor family, so he also had to struggle, he had to study under public light, street light, and then finally he also, with his lot of hard work, knowledge, perseverance, etc., he rose to become the greatest engineer that India has ever produced. He was instrumental in the construction of Krishnarajasagara dam in Karnataka, and he even became Diwan of Mysore. So while writing these two things, then after that you have to write stating that the common point in both the things is both the great personalities, why at the time of starting, at the time of beginning, both of them were very poor, very marginalized. It was development at their individual level, it was their individual development that brought them out of poverty. That means it was their individual development that gave them economic freedom, if I may call so. However, one striking contrast is that though both of them became financially, economically successful, Ambedkar continued to face the stigma of lower caste attached to him even until his death, that prompted him to convert himself to Buddhism towards the end of his life. Thus, though their hard work, individual development provided them economic freedom, it did not provide social freedom to Ambedkar, while that social freedom was already accorded to Sir M. Visveshwaraya, that is later, from his birth itself. So thus this essay seeks to explore and investigate the intricate relationships between development and human unfreedoms. So like that you can write, and you can start writing your essay. Then friends, before you jump into the actual exploration or elaboration of the topic, you need to set the proper stage for the same. Actually, setting the stage means first you have to explain the meaning of and the relationship between two major terms. One is development and the other one is freedom. Friends, what is development? In the simplest terms, development means expansion of choices. That means for a person, if he has the availability of various means for the satisfaction of his needs, then that means development. That means, let us say, take the example of a village. If there is only one school in the village, there is no choice for anybody, for the parent. Parent is forced to send his or her child only to that school. So thus, if there are three schools, that means the scenario of three schools is a developed version of a village having only one school. So, expansion of choices. That means every person has a need. How is that need satisfied? That need can be satisfied through various alternatives, various means. If
limited number of means are available for satisfaction of a particular need, then that is underdevelopment. If more choices are available, more means are available, then that is development. So thus, development means expansion of choices or increase in the availability of choices. So more schools, more hospitals, more job opportunities, more industries, more factories signify development. Okay, friends? That means expansion of choices is development. Then what is freedom? If development is expansion of choices, freedom is ability and liberty to choose amongst the available choices is freedom. There may be three schools in a village. One is a government school and remaining two are private schools. Let us say so for the sake of understanding. Though two more schools have come up signifying the development, if the villagers do not have the financial means to send his or her child to a private school, then again the choices get restricted to his or her extent. So thus, while development signifies expansion of available means, freedom signifies liberty and ability to choose amongst the available means. So thus it is thus there is a intricate relationship, thus there is a close nexus between development and freedom. Development coupled with human freedoms can only script a saga of a successful society or a successful country. So this explanation is very much important. So while to put it in other words, so under freedom there are two things. One is liberty and the ability to choose. Ability to choose has everything to do with financial means. Liberty to choose has everything to do with social customs, conventions and other restrictions that are in place. That may be even safety restrictions, security concerns, whatever. So, thus it is, thus any country or society said to have developed, if and only if, the choices get expanded. Second, if the individual citizens of that country or society acquire means as well as have means as well as liberty to choose amongst the available thing, then only a country or a society is said to have become better from what it was earlier. Okay. So this is how you have to first set the stage for your essay. Necessarily your introduction actually would end with Sir M. Vishwesvarayaji's example and then whatever little relationship link you establish. But actually this you can even consider to be your second component, but it's very important. Whatever I have explained, you have to, it becomes very important to explain these things. If you explain these concepts very clearly, in one para you explain the concept of development, in another para you explain the concept of freedom or unfreedom, whatever, and then in the third para you try to link between development and freedom or unfreedom, then you can again start stating that. So having understood the relationship between development and freedom and unfreedom, before going into the elaboration, so let us try to explore various types of unfreedoms that we would encounter in society. Thus, this will act as a linker for this component and the subsequent component. Friends, the topic talks about all kinds of human unfreedoms. Since it is practically impossible to speak about every possible human unfreedom, for the sake of convenience, in the stipulated time and word limit, we need to enlist a few of the unfreedoms that we would intend to discuss in the essay. For the say, I have listed down these unfreedoms. So economic unfreedom, political, social, societal and environmental unfreedom. Friends, now you have to explain about each unfreedom in a paragraph or so. The first one is economic unfreedom, friends. What is this economic unfreedom? You know, that freedom means having the ability and liberty to choose, right? Then what is unfreedom? Not having the ability or liberty to choose is unfreedom. Then what is economic unfreedom? Economic unfreedom means having not having ability or liberty to engage, to choose amongst various trades or occupations or businesses in order to make money. To illustrate, there are ample of choices available before every individual to engage in and earn wealth, money, right? That means you can start a business, you can put up a shop, you can work as an employee, you can work as a daily wage laborer, you can start your own business, anything. So you can do consultancy services, there is no end. So this is availability of choices. But if a person, in order to engage in any of these crafts or occupations or businesses or trades, whatever, if a person should have first ability to engage in it, second one is liberty. First, what is ability? Simple. Ability means he should, to start a business, he should have money or he should have skill set. If you don't have skill, you don't have money, that means there is economic unfreedom. What is liberty? That means there should be everybody should have opportunity to engage in every type of trade or business or occupation or employment or guild, whatever. Okay, so this is what economic unfreedom is all about. That means not having either financial means to engage in the trade or business a person intends to do. Second, not having the requisite skill sets, educational qualifications to engage in a particular trade or so. Third one, having societal restrictions in engaging in a particular trade or activity. Correct. So in earlier days, actually in the ancient India for that matter, even some lower caste people were barred from doing puja. They were, it's also an occupation, right? They were barred from engaging in some occupations which were regarded to be the forte of upper caste people. Thus, there was no liberty. Even today, you can see women who constitute 50% of the population, 50% of the society, they are barred from engaging in some occupations. Societally, women are not allowed to get into security forces, in police department, army, etc., etc., etc. Still, those things are regarded to be forte of male, their male fiefdoms. So, this is lack of liberty. Hope I have made the concept of economic unfreedom very clear. Now, let us go to political unfreedom. First one is economic unfreedom. Second one is political unfreedom. Again, one should have the ability and liberty to choose. First one, the political system that should govern him. Okay. Second, he should have the ability and liberty to choose as to how the governance policies should affect him or her. So here, take the example of Taliban. Afghanistan. So now in Afghanistan, do you think Afghani citizens have the liberty or ability, whatever, to choose as to how they should be governed? No. Same is the case with many dictatorship countries. So all such regimes where democracy is absent, where people don't have political freedom. But take countries like India, America, etc., etc., where democracy is deep rooted. Here people have that political freedom because they have both ability and liberty to choose as to what type of political system should govern them. Second, who should govern them as being part of that political system. By political system, I mean whether they want a direct democracy or indirect democracy or say communism or socialism. Second thing is, they should have the liberty and ability to choose who should take the reins of such political system, that is through elections, how those people should govern others, okay. Here, this is the best example of political unfreedom. Now you will ask me a question. Sir, for economic unfreedom, you spoke about ability and liberty. Then what is this ability, what is this liberty for political unfreedom? Friends, liberty means everybody is allowed to vote in a democracy, which is not so in other countries. So that liberty is anyway given, is the power or the right given by the constitution. What is this ability? Ability is whether they have the citizens or the individuals have the required amount of intellectual capabilities to understand the development or development of a country or a society as a whole, whether they are able to make informed choices or they are making misleading, they are being misled by misinformation to make wrong choices. Whether the citizens have the ability to understand the issues and based upon an informed understanding whether they are choosing or not. This is what we actually mean by ability for that. Then the third one is social unfreedom. Friends, what is social development, friends? It's not just limited to SA. Everywhere social development means development in two major sectors, health and education. Okay? So thus, social unfreedom actually means, do we have, whether the citizens have the ability and liberty to choose the various means for education as well as health. Ability means, again, whether they have money to go to any school they want, to get treated in any hospital they want. Liberty is anyway, whether everyone is allowed in every educational institution or not. As simple as that. Now, after social unfreedom, it is societal unfreedom, friends. Then what is this societal unfreedom? Friends, whether every individual has ability and liberty to choose to visit all community spaces, whether every individual has ability and liberty to marry whoever he or she wishes to, whether every individual has ability and liberty to befriend with anybody else. So these are all some of the strands on which the concept of societal freedom or unfreedom is based. So now take the example of Mahatma Gandhiji. Mahatma Gandhiji had the ability to buy a first class train ticket. He was traveling in that first class train, but he was thrown out of the train. Why? Because though he had, the train is a common space, community space, if I may call so. It's a public transport. There, Gandhiji had the ability to buy a ticket, but he did not have the liberty to travel in first class train. Thus, what Gandhiji suffered then was societal unfreedom. The whatever, I mean, we are very well aware, right? Dogs and Indians are not allowed. Dogs and blacks are not allowed. These such types of boards used to be put up in British India, British Africa, where one entire community was barred from attending or visiting a societal community space. Similar is the case with, various temples in India also. In the previous times, as most of us are aware, people belonging to many lower castes were not allowed to enter into the temple. So thus, they did not have the liberty to enter a community space. So this is societal unfreedom. This is also one of the major unfreedoms that we encounter. Then the last one is environmental unfreedom. Friends, what is environment? Environment is composed of this pancha bhutas. I mean, if you may call so, like, basically environment is something that comprises air, water, plants, trees, etc., etc., etc. What is this environmental unfreedom? Whether if an individual has the ability and liberty to breathe fresh air, to drink clean water, to live in a peaceful place devoid of the noises, then it is a scenario of environmental freedom. If a person does not have the ability to breathe fresh air, if a person does not have the liberty to drink clean water, then it is a scenario of environmental unfreedom. Friends, even today, people living in metropolitan cities, cosmopolitan cities, though they have money to afford to breathe fresh air, but thanks to vehicular exhaust, thanks to factory exhausts, industry exhausts, do they really get to breathe fresh air? No. That means though they have ability to pay for fresh air, they don't have liberty to breathe fresh air. So in such scenarios, that is what I would brand as environmental unfreedom. So thus, under this component, you have to explain each of various unfreedoms one after the other. But before you jump into the next topic, then you can very well say that the list of unfreedoms is just indicative but not exhaustive. But in view of the space constraint, it has been restricted to these things. If you write like that, that gives evaluator a very good feel. Friends, now we have landed in the heart of the essay. I have always told you, even in my previous videos, that heart of the essay is where we do critical examination, critical analysis of the issue. Correct. Now that we have discussed about various unfreedoms, now it is time for us to describe and analyze as to whether development will dismantle all these unfreedoms, or whether all these unfreedoms completely, or whether this will fail to dismantle all these unfreedoms completely, or whether this will dismantle a few of these freedoms while not dismantling a few of these freedoms, or is there any such freedom, unfreedom, which gets partially dismantled by development? Correct. These are some of the questions that would have to be addressed under this section. So friends, here, according to me, this need not have to be your opinion. You are free to choose your opinion, but only thing is that whatever you choose, you have to substantiate it logically. Here, what does it say? According to me, economic unfreedom and social unfreedoms get dismantled by development, while environmental unfreedom gets dismantled only partially, but political and societal unfreedoms have nothing to do with development. This is the stand that I have taken. So you have to explain one after the other. So first, let us say economic unfreedom. What is economic unfreedom? I already explained to you in the previous slide. So there it means having both ability and liberty to engage in any trade or business in order to make money. Correct. So here, if there is economic development, there are more financial institutions, there are more banks. If there are more banks, more financial institutions, more venture capitalists, then perhaps that the ability to engage in any trade in terms of finance becomes very easy. Correct, right? I don't have money, but I have an excellent business idea I want to engage myself in. I don't have money. I can approach a bank. I can approach a financial institution. I can approach even government. I can approach venture capitalist. Finally, I'll get money. Where it happens only with development, right? If there is underdevelopment, then we will have the number of the such institutions which would finance such businesses is only less. And even government also will not have any schemes in order to encourage such budding entrepreneurs. Thus, with economic development, one, there is scope for increase or mushrooming of such institutions or organizations which would fund other businesses. Second, with increased economic development, the government budget also expands and government also will be able to have its own schemes in order to encourage budding entrepreneurs. Thus, the problem of ability is taken care of, right, by development. And the second one is liberty. See, anyway, there is not much restriction. So whenever you have money, it is very easy for you to enter into any business and make money. So thus, this development will necessarily ensure that economic unfreedom is totally dismantled. You go to a country like USA where anybody can start any business. That is because of the rich development. You go to a country like Africa, you cannot do much. The choice is very much limited. Next, let us come to social development. Social unfreedom. Social unfreedom. See, whenever there is development, I told you, what is development? Expansion of choices. Expansion of available alternatives. Expansion of available means to achieve a particular end is what I explained it as development. With more economic development, that means people have more money with them. When people have more money with them, in order to capitalize on such increased purchasing power of the people, there will be more schools, more hospitals, right? And also, government also will have more budget at its disposal. Then government will also support people or students to go to colleges of their choice. The entire concept of subsidized education offered by the government, subsidized healthcare offered by the government, and even, for example, even Ayushman Bharat of Government of India or YSR Arogya Shri of Andhra Government or Yashaswini scheme of Karnataka government, all these things have ensured that inability to choose the hospital to go has been done away with by these schemes. How have these schemes emerged? These schemes have emerged only because the government has money to finance and fund those activities. So how has government got this money? Government has got this money by collecting taxes. When can government collect more taxes? Only when there is economic development, there is more economic activity, more income, more taxes, more channelization of funds to such schemes. So thus, social unfreedom also gets dismantled by development. Now let us come to the next arena, that is environmental unfreedom. As I told you in the previous slide itself, environmental freedom equals ability and liberty to choose to breathe fresh air, to drink clean water, and to enjoy fruits of better environment. Correct. Now, on the face of it, it appears that development will enable a person to access water purifying solutions. A person can take even air purifiers. A person can decide to relocate to a place where the air quality and water quality are better or desirable. However, friends, though the development on the face of it appears that it will enable a person to dismantle the environmental unfreedom imposed upon him, but friends, the mere fact that the why a person had to choose clean air or clean water at the first place, this water, air, or other components of environment have become undesirable, polluted, contaminated because of this development only, right? Development exploits natural resources. At the same time, development releases, discharges undesirable components into the environment. These two major problems associated with the development have actually necessitated the need for seeking a better air, better water, better environmental products. So thus, I would say, though development gives a person ability and to some extent even liberty to choose for a better environmental product, But even then, the mere fact that the something that was freely available is made expensive is because of development only. Thus, I personally take the stand that environmental unfreedom gets dismantled only partially by the development. Now, friends, now let us jump to the third one, that is political unfreedom and social unfreedom. According to me, of course, you are free to differ with me and argue in your own way in your essays. It is just an indicative thing. Political unfreedom has nothing to do with development, according to me. We are seeing countries like China, where communist form of government is there, where people absolutely have no political freedom, yet the development has not ensured that they got economic freedom. Sorry, they have not got any political freedom. Similarly, there are let us take the example of Afghanistan now. Though, do you think any amount of development will uproot Taliban and bring a democratic government there? No, right? Thus, development need not provide political freedom to the citizens. According to me, there is not much causal relationship between development and political freedom or unfreedom. So, next let us take the societal unfreedom. Friends, though this is where you need to again link your example of Ambedkar at the introduction. Though Ambedkar could become an educationist, though Ambedkar was an highly acclaimed scholar, though he could come out of that poverty because of his grit, hard work, perseverance, determination, whatnot, yet the society did not accept Ambedkar wholeheartedly. Of course, now the situation has changed. Now much water has flown, there is change in the societal attitude, etc., etc. But at that point of time, it was his individual development did not lead to dismantling the societal unfreedoms that were imposed on him. So, this is the same scenario for so many working women in India for today. So women go out, they manage both their professional work as well as they manage their family at the same time. Yet, some unfreedoms that are imposed on them, major decisions in the family are taken by men. So many other things, such unfreedoms are still continuing. So development need not dismantle such societal unfreedoms. So this political unfreedoms and societal unfreedoms get dismantled not through development, but through revolutions, but through movements, but through socio-religious reform mechanisms actually. Of course, some of these revolutions and some of these socio-religious reform mechanisms may get accentuated or accelerated by development. However, development does not directly dismantle these political unfreedoms and societal unfreedoms. Friends, now that we have argued that a few unfreedoms get dismantled only partially by development, a few don't get dismantled at all. Now then, it's necessary for us to initiate a dialogue in order to give a ray of hope to the examiner also, that what kind of development would actually ensure that even such unfreedoms get dismantled completely. Friends, I need not have to tell you, equitable development and inclusive development will definitely play their role in doing away with some of the societal unfreedoms. Correct, right, friends? Now let us think about pre-1990 India and post-1990 India after liberalization, globalization, whatever, LPG. See, now that thanks to this increased economic development, which is getting inclusive because the government is somehow ensuring that every individual has equal access to education, health, skill development, etc., etc. Now, every community, every individual has equal opportunity to grow. Once the fruits of development get shared by every individual, then they tend to work together, they tend to invest together, they tend to operate together. Once such commercial operations between people of various sections of society become inevitable and interrelated, then slowly, slowly these societal unfreedoms get dismantled. That means, let us take the example of intercaste marriages that are becoming more and more common in today's India, which was a taboo earlier. Now that every individual who gets educated and gets placed in a corporate firm, then regardless of their caste, when they meet each other, when they like each other and they get married regardless of their caste. Thus, once one intercaste marriage happens, then slowly, slowly in that family, that society, that attitude starts changing slowly. So, thus it is, but why has this happened? This has happened only because even people from lower caste could get educated, could get a job in a corporate firm. Thus, it was only that inclusive development that has led to this intercaste marriage. So, thus, an inclusive development has the potential to break societal unfreedoms also. And also, we are seeing earlier some temples were barred. Some individuals were barred from entering the temples. Now, every community has started building their own temple. So, that is because of inclusive development. Thus, exclusivity of the god is no longer so. So, slowly, slowly, this inclusive and equitable development will break societal unfreedoms also. But if the development is lopsided, if the development is exclusive to only a certain communities, then the societal unfreedoms don't get dismantled by any means. Okay? Then next comes sustainable development. We know what is sustainable development. This ability to meet our needs without compromising on the abilities of the future generations to meet their own needs. So, this sustainable development techniques will definitely attempt to ameliorate the environmental unfreedoms being imposed nowadays. Okay. Now, the obvious question is what kind of development will eliminate the political unfreedom also. Normally, friends, if you see the Jasmine Revolution, take the example of Libya, Egypt, everywhere, normally this underdevelopment is something that leads to overthrowing of non-democratic governments. It is not development. So, because whenever there is development, obviously people are happy. When people are happy, when they have access to whatever they want, then perhaps they don't worry about political unfreedoms. Thus, friends, it is, according to me, it's my personal opinion, you're free to differ. It is only underdevelopment that will try to eliminate political unfreedoms. So far as political unfreedom is concerned, if there is development, then obviously people are happy. See, the objective of any country or any political setup is to ensure that people are happy and there is development. If that is happening, then why would people rise against the government? Correct. So, thus, it is more of its underdevelopment, not the development, that will seek to remove or dismantle this political unfreedom. But however, with this increased this equitable inclusive development will necessarily empower the citizens, to become a pressure group, and they will be in a better position to pressurize the government to frame policies that are for the betterment of everyone. See, thus I would say, I would try to draw parallels between the moderates in the Indian freedom struggle. Moderates, how they try to bring independence to India through 3 P's, right? So, petition, prayer and protest. So, moderates represented developed India at that point of time. So, thus, they also try to bring some amount, they also try to break some amount of political unfreedom through their own means. Thus, with more development, we will mostly see the attempts through petitions, prayers, and also pressurizing. Such evolutionary means would be employed in order to dismantle political unfreedoms. However, it is only unfreedom through revolution that will enable and ensure that political unfreedoms get dismantled totally, fully, in a very short span of time. So thus, in the conclusion, we can very well state that it is not mere development that will lead to dismantling all kinds of human unfreedoms, but it is inclusive development, inclusive societal sense, coupled with inclusive state, that will definitely dismantle all kinds of human unfreedoms. Of course, inclusive development, you know, inclusive societal sense means all are equal types. Then inclusive state means, so the state will, whether it is democracy or otherwise, it is that inclusive state where the opinion of everybody matters. Something like this. So thus, it is not just development, but inclusive development, inclusive societal sense coupled with inclusive state, that will definitely dismantle all kinds of human unfreedom. So this is how we need to conclude. Friends, before I sign off, I just want to draw your attention to one very important thing. If you can observe my discussion on this essay topic, this is actually based on the stage setting that I did soon after introduction. That is expansion of choices and ability and liberty to choose. If thus I have ensured that my essay, entire essay, revolves around this concept. So if you learn to set the stage or tone for the essay properly at the beginning, and you develop your essay by linking every component to the way the tone is set, so then obviously your essay appears sound, coherent, and if an examiner will feel that you have not meandered or gone away from the topic, then you'll definitely end up getting good marks. So thank you, friends. Wish you happy reading.